The United States Steel Corporation, 500,000 stockholders and employees, presents the Theater Guild on the Air. The United States Steel Corporation presents the Theater Guild, one of America's foremost theatrical producers, bringing into your home every Sunday evening, from the stage of the Vanderbilt Theater in New York, the most famous plays of Broadway. Tonight we bring you the distinguished and charming star of the American theater, Miss Lynn Fontanne, playing Nina Leeds in part two of Eugene O'Neill's prize-winning drama, Strange Interlude. Featured with Miss Fontanne in this great play by America's leading dramatist is Walter Abel as Dr. Ned Darrell, together with Donald MacDonald as Sam Evans, Alfred Shirley as Charles Marsden, Donald Bucher as Gordon the Man, Michael Artist as Gordon the Boy, and Joan Tompkins as Madeline. Here is Lawrence Langner, co-director with Teresa Helburn of the Theater Guild, to introduce the play. Mr. Langner.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Our play tonight not only won the Pulitzer Prize, but was also largely responsible for the award to Eugene O'Neill, its author, of the Nobel Prize for Literature. Strange Interlude has been played in the theaters of almost every civilized country, and right now is being given with great success in Milan, Italy, under the auspices of the Catholic Theater Center. The second part of Strange Interlude is substantially a complete play in itself, and those of you who did not listen in last week will easily be able to follow tonight and to hear some of the most exciting and dramatic scenes in the play. Lynn Fontanne, who plays the part of Nina tonight, created this role in the original stage production. And now the curtain rises on the second part of Strange Interlude.
My name is Charles Marsden. I'm a writer, the author of a dozen lovingly created novels, all carefully manicured so as not to offend or to give pain or to cause you to think that life is anything but beautiful. And now, toward the end of my life, I find myself telling a story that does not meet these specifications. The story of Nina Evans and Sam, her husband, and Dr. Darrell and myself. I've already told you about Nina and how she had been engaged to Gordon Shaw, who was shot down in the First World War. Grieving for Gordon almost killed Nina. She was in a dangerous neurotic state when Sam Evans came along. Dr. Darrell and I advised her to marry Sam, to have children. We thought it might make her forget Gordon. She did marry him, but there were no children because Sam's mother, meeting Nina for the first time, had told her, well, let Nina tell it, as she told it later to Dr. Darrell.
You see, Doctor, it's a great secret. Even Sam doesn't know. His great-grandfather was insane, and his grandmother died in an asylum, and his father lost his mind for years before he died, and an aunt who is still alive is crazy. But I know now. Pretty picture, isn't it?
As the months went by and Nina bore Sam Evans no child, Sam became more and more despondent. He was licked. And then after weeks of searching her soul, Nina spoke to Dr. Ned Darrell.
There was something else Sam's mother said, Doctor. She said, Nina, when I was carrying Sam, I used to wish his father had been anybody else. Anybody else. You understand? You have courage. It would be easy for you. Easy, she said. It would be easy for me.
Exactly what is it you want of me?
I want your advice, your scientific advice, Doctor.
Well, Sam's mother is right. Nina, I observe this as a scientific experiment. Sam's wife should have a child. It's her duty to her husband. Without a child, he would go to pieces.
You must give Sam's wife courage, Doctor. You must free her from her feeling of guilt and shame. Please, Doctor, take the patient's hand. Now she has the courage, Doctor, to ask you to suggest the father, to suggest that you... Oh, Ned, I should be so grateful. I should be so humbly grateful.
Yes, Nina, in that spirit, only in that spirit.
And then, a few months before the child was born, Sam Evans, Nina's husband, spoke to Dr. Ned Darrell.
Nina wants you to stay to lunch, Ned. She says there's something important you both want to tell me.
Of course I'll stay to lunch, Sam.
Of course I'll stay to lunch, Sam. That's what Dr. Darrell said. But what was he really thinking? I've got to tell you that because in this story I'm telling you also hear what people think. These were Dr. Darrell's thoughts.
After lunch, she wants to tell Sam. Tell her own husband she loves me now, that I love her, that the child is mine. No, I can't. It would kill him. And my career, finished. Love, I'm caught in it. She touches my hand, her eyes get in mine, I lose my will. I've got to find a way out. I've got to. Europe, that's it. I'll run away. Look here, Sam, I can't stay to lunch. I've got to pick up my passport. I'm sailing for Europe, you know.
But what's the big secret, Ned?
Well, you're going to be a father, old man. Your wife's going to have a baby. And now I've got to run. I'll see you again in a year or so. Give my love to Nina. So long.
And that was that. The great revelation was postponed for the time being. One Sunday afternoon, about a year later, we were in the library of Nina's house in a New York suburb. Nina sat beside the open fire. She was sewing on something for the baby. Gordon, she called him, after the other Gordon who was killed. I glanced at her over the top of my newspaper, wondering what she was thinking.
I wonder if there's a draft in the baby's room. Maybe I better close the window. Little Gordon. Why hasn't Ned written? It's better he hasn't. I forgive him. I have my baby.
Nina! You downstairs?
Yes, Sam. Here I am, dear, with Charlie.
Sam's a wonderful father. He's become a new man in the past year. I have a genuine respect for him now. And I'm making him happy. How queerly things worked out. And I don't feel wicked. I feel good.
Hello, dear. How do you feel? Hi, Charlie. How's the boy?
Hello, Sam. I'm as always, good old Charlie. By the way, Nina, did I tell you I ran into Dr. Darrell in Munich?
You saw Ned?
You saw Ned? Why hadn't he told me before? Why did he look at me like that? Does he suspect?
Yes, I happened to run into him.
That struck home. Look at her, guilty. Nina and Darrell. Then I was right when I thought...
When I saw him, he was with rather a startling-looking blonde, quite beautiful, if you like the type. I gather they were very good friends.
Why, tell me, Charlie. It's nothing to me if he has 50 blondes.
Nothing to me? Oh, Ned, why haven't you written? Stop it. What a fool I am. Ned's dead for me. Oh, I hate Charlie. Why did he have to tell me?
Did Ned say anything about coming back?
No, but he did ask about you, Nina. Wanted to know about your baby.
Ha-ha, it's too bad he couldn't see what a world beater we've got, huh, Nina?
Yes, dear. Ned asked about my baby. And he hasn't forgotten. If he came back, he'd come to see his baby.
Hadn't you better go up and have a look at young Gordon?
Yes, dear, I'm going now. See you later, Charlie.
Wait, Nina, I'll come with you. I want to say goodnight to my son. Be right down, Charlie.
All right.
What happened then? That look in her eyes when I mentioned Darrell. Does she still... What am I hoping for? What do I want? If Nina were free, what could I offer her? Myself? What a pride.
Ah, that kid is certainly a world beater, Charlie. When he grows up, he'll be a crack athlete. I'm going to train him for that.
Now, how about training his mind, Sam?
That'll take care of itself. He's got Nina for a mother, hasn't he?
You're the only genuinely modest person I know, Sam.
Oh, me. I'm the boob of the family. Except when it comes to business. I'll make the money, and you can bet your sweet life on that.
Well, I'm quite sure of that.
You know, Charlie, I couldn't have said that 2 years ago. But since the baby was born, I felt as if I had a shot of dynamite in each arm. Well, I guess I'll go out and sit on the back porch. Soak up some sun. Want to come along?
No, no, thanks. I'll just stay here. I want to think out the plot of my new novel.
Go to it, old man. See you later.
Go to it, old man. How that idiot patronizes me. Dear old Charlie. Nice doggy. We've had him for years.
Open the door. Charlie, will you please?
All right. Well, if it isn't...
Who is it, Charlie?
It's I, Nina. Ned Darrell.
Ned! Oh, make yourself at home. I'll be right down.
All right, Nina.
Here, in this house again. I've dreamed of it. Ran away from here once. Now I've come back. My turn to be happy.
You're looking fine, Doctor.
Now I know absolutely his face, her voice. They did love each other.
When did you get back from Europe?
This morning on the Aquitania. Look out for this Marsden. Always had it in for me. Smells out love like a woman. Well, what do I care now? It's all got to come out. Nina wanted to tell Sam. Now I'll tell him myself.
What brought you back so soon? When I saw you in Munich...
My father died 3 weeks ago. I've had to come back about his estate. That's a lie. I came back because I love her. I'm licked. No use fighting it. I've done my best.
That's Nina coming now, Darrell.
She's coming. In a second, I'll see you. Does she still love me? She may have forgotten... No, it's my child. She can't forget that.
Ned.
Hello, Nina.
This is a wonderful surprise. He loves me. I can tell. He's mine. Now more than ever. He'll never dare leave me again. How are you, Ned? When did you get back?
All right, Nina.
Darrell's father died, Nina. He had to come back to see about the estate.
Your father, Ned? Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, I was coming back anyway. I was coming back anyway, Nina.
Were you? You darling, as if I didn't know that. Oh, my dearest.
You're going to be amazed at the change in Sam, Darrell. If ever a man was bound for success, Sam is. You know, he's the proudest parent I've ever seen.
Really? What's he driving at? Why doesn't he get the devil out of here and leave us alone? But I'm glad Sam is on his feet. Makes it easier to tell him the truth.
Yes, Sam makes a wonderful father, Ned. What's Charlie talking about? Oh, Ned, I do love you. And I already know what you're hoping, darling. But I can't. I can't take Sam's baby away from him. I can't run away with you and leave my baby.
If anything happened to that child, I actually believe Sam would lose his reason. Don't you think so, Nina?
I know I'd lose mine. Little Gordon has become my whole life. You'll love him too, Ned.
I'm sure I will, Nina. Little Gordon. Nina called my son after Gordon, who's dead. Gordon, her first love, is still her lover. Gordon, Sam, and Nina, and my son. Closed corporation. I'm forced out. No, not yet. I'll smash it up. I'll tell Sam the truth.
I said, Sam, you're here. You two probably have a lot to talk over.
Nina.
Ned. Oh, darling.
Nina, I've come back to you. Do you still care, Nina?
I love you. Ned, come here. Come here into my arms.
I didn't know. You seemed so cold just now. Confound Marsden. He suspects, doesn't he? But it makes no difference now, does it? Oh, it's been horrible, Nina. I couldn't forget you. Other women, they only made me love you more. Lord, how I thought of you lying awake, recalling every word you said, every expression on your face, smelling your hair. Nina, I love you so.
And I've longed for you so. Do you think I've forgotten? Do you? Oh, Ned, why did you run away?
I was a fool. I thought of Sam. Oh, it wasn't all noble, I'll confess. I thought of myself and my career. My career, a lot of good it did that. But I know better now. The time for lying is past.
Yes.
You've got to come away with me.
Yes, yes. No. Oh, no. You're forgetting Sam and Sam's baby.
Sam's baby? Are you joking? Why, we'll take him with us, of course.
And Sam...
He's got to give you a divorce. Let him be generous for a change.
Oh, he would be.
You'd have to admit that, Ned.
Well, all the better, then.
Sam would give his life for my happiness. And that's what this would mean, his life. Could we be happy then? You know we couldn't.
But we could.
And I've changed, Ned. You've got to realize that. I still love you. I'll always love you. But now I love my baby, too. His happiness comes first with me. We mustn't forget Sam.
Sam, Sam. For the Lord's sake, Nina, you haven't come to love Sam, have you? Then I'll go. I'll go away again. I'll never come back. I tried not to this time, but I had to, Nina.
Put your arms around me, darling. Kiss me. Oh, don't go away, darling, ever again. I don't love Sam. I love you.
But I don't understand. Sam gets everything and I get nothing.
Oh, you have my love.
And that's what you call playing fair to
Sam? It's the only possible solution, Ned, for all our sakes.
Nina, how can you be so inhuman and calculating?
It was you who taught me the scientific approach, wasn't it?
You think I'll stay. Come to this house, watch Sam with the woman I love and my child. You think that's what I came back to you for? You can go to the devil, Nina.
What else can I do? Shh, they're coming, dear Sam and Charlie.
What else can you do, liar? But I can do something else. I can smash your whole calculating game for you. I can tell Sam, and I will now.
No, no, you won't. You can't do that to Sam.
The devil I can.
Shh. Ned, you old son of a gun. Well, why didn't you let a guy know you were coming? You look thin. Oh, we'll fatten him up, though, won't we, Nina? Why, you old
Mercy,
son of
Sam,
a...
Sam, give Ned a chance to get a word in.
Sure, Sam, give him a chance. Nina, why are you tapping with that thimble? You're not nervous, are you?
Nervous? Why should I be?
Darrell, it couldn't be that you have something to tell, Sam, could it?
Tell me, Ned. I've got something to show you. My son. Ned, that kid's a world beater. He's the most intelligent, best-looking, smartest kid that ever...
dear, Ned will see him later. Ned, do you want to tell Sam something?
Yes. I mean, no. Sam, I just want to say how darn glad I am about everything. Can't tell him, I can't tell him, I can't tell him.
Oh, thanks, Ned, thanks.
We both thank you, Ned. There, that's settled for all time. Poor Ned, how crushed he looks. I mustn't let them look at him. If we're going to talk, we may as well sit down. You there, Charlie, and you over there, Sam, and you there, Ned. That's it. Make yourselves at home. You're my three men. This is your home with me. I should be the happiest woman in the world. Only I'd better knock on wood.
My three men. I feel their desires converge in me to form one complete, beautiful desire which I absorb. They dissolve in me. Their life is my life. Three. And the fourth man, little Gordon, he is mine too. That makes it perfect. Why, I should be the proudest woman on earth. I'd better knock on wood.
Moment, we will continue with the second act of Strange Interlude, produced by the Theater Guild on the air and presented by the United States Steel Corporation. Here speaking for the United States Steel Corporation is George Hicks.
Did you ever stop to realize that no matter who you are or what you do, your daily life depends to a great extent on the movement of freight over America's wonderfully efficient railroads? Consider these two essentials, your food and your fuel. Without the steady and efficient movement of these vital necessities by rail, you'd soon have a mighty hard time keeping well fed and warm. And remember this fact, too. The more economically these and thousands of other essentials are moved by rail, the less they cost you and the better you live. Now, one of the most important factors in the low cost of modern freight transportation by rail is the use of steel. Together with the kind of research that continually provides the railroad industry with better steels for more economical operation. Let me give you just one example. Last week, I learned of a brand new development, a new kind of all-welded hopper car that weighs 6,540 pounds less than the regular steel car. It was designed by the Railroad Research Bureau of United States Steel, and it's built of Core 10, the amazing steel which gets its name from its corrosion resistance coupled with high tensile strength. The saving in weight permitted by the use of Core 10 is translated into increased load capacity. That means more freight can be carried without increased total weight. Since 1934, when Core 10 steel was first introduced, car builders and railroads have used this versatile steel in more than 65,000 freight cars, with an average saving in dead weight of more than 2.5 tons per car, which means a total saving of millions of dollars in freight hauling costs. Now I realize that many of you have never seen one of these hopper cars, the latest of which just last week began in Roanoke, Virginia, an exhibition tour of railroad centers. But you've probably seen some of the streamlined locomotives and coaches, trolley cars, buses, and tank trucks built with Core 10. It is one of the steels you are sure to see more and more. One of the outstanding steels developed by United States Steel's research program to provide better transportation and better living.
We pause now for station identification.
This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company. This is KECA, Los Angeles.
And now the curtain rises on the second act of Eugene O'Neill's Pulitzer Prize-winning drama, Strange Interlude, starring Lynn Fontanne as Nina and featuring Walter Abel, with Donald MacDonald, Alfred Shirley, Donald Buca, Michael Artist, and Joan Tompkins.
Years went by. The advertising agency which Sam had acquired became one of the most successful in the city, and the lives of all of us took on the routine of a well-ordered existence. Nina and her three men. Only Darrell would escape for a time to Paris or Antigua, but he always came back. The pull of Nina was too strong. Gordon's 11th birthday. He stretched out on the floor of the living room in Sam Evans' Park Avenue apartment. Nina, 35 now, watches him lovingly. And Darrell watches Nina. What are they thinking, these three? Let's find out. Young Gordon first.
I wish Darrell would get out of here. Why couldn't Mother let me run my own birthday? I'd never have him here, you bet. What's he always hanging around here for? It's a good thing for him he didn't bring me any birthday presents. I'd smash it first chance I got.
That was Gordon, age 11, thinking of the father he didn't know was his father. And now, Nina.
No longer my baby. 11 years. I can't believe it. How handsome he is. Poor Ned. I've made him suffer a great deal. If he could only have been contented with what I was able to give him. But he always wanted more, yet never had the courage to insist on all or nothing. Proud without being proud enough. He has shared me for his comfort with a little gratitude and a big bitterness.
And now the thoughts of Dr. Ned Darrell.
What is she thinking? We sit together in silence, thinking. Thoughts that never know the other's thoughts, strangers. Well, whatever it is that binds us together, it's strong. Once when she saw there was some chance I might break loose, she found some way to pull me back, and I forgot my longing for freedom. I came back, wagging my tail. Well, I hope my experiment has proved something.
When are you going back to the West Indies, Ned?
Soon.
I don't see how you can afford to leave your work for such long periods.
My work?
Your experiments and things, don't you grow rusty?
My life work is to rust, nicely and unobtrusively. My real work was finished 12 years ago. As I believe you know, I ended it with an experiment which resulted so successfully that any further meddling with human lives would be superfluous.
Oh, how can you be so bitter, Ned, on Gordon's birthday?
Bitterness knows no holidays, Nina. She expects me to love the child she deliberately took from me and gave to another man. No, thank you, Nina. I've been hurt enough. I'll not leave myself open there. Every day he gets more like Sam, doesn't he?
Sure I do. I look just like my dad.
Better watch out. Better look out what he says about my father.
You know, Ned, he always reminds me of his namesake, Gordon Shaw.
Gordon? Not a bit. I'd much rather have him grow up to be an exact duplicate of the esteemed Samuel.
He's always making fun of my father. He'd better look out.
You, Darryl, you shut up making fun of my father.
Gordon.
My dear boy, I wouldn't make fun of your father for the world.
You're dead, too. I hate you.
Oh, Gordon, how dare you talk like that to your Uncle Ned.
He's not my uncle. He's not my any.
Not another word or you will be punished, whether it's your birthday or not.
Is this my fault? I've done my best to get him to love Ned, but it only makes him worse.
I don't care. I'll tell Dad.
Well, leave the room and don't come near me again, do you hear, until you've apologized to your Uncle Ned.
Oh, never mind, Nina.
I'll leave the room, but I won't apologize. Never.
What if he does hate me? I don't blame him.
He shouldn't say he hates you.
Nina, let me warn you about your son. If you'd keep his love, hate me. Hate me as he does.
Oh, no, no, I won't believe it. If Gordon doesn't love you, it's because you've never made the slightest attempt to be lovable to him. It's his birthday today, and you never even brought him a present, Ned.
I did bring him a present. It's out in the hall. I bought him a costly, delicate one, so he can get full satisfaction and yet not strain himself when he smashes it, as he smashed every present of mine in the past.
Oh, Ned, don't torture us both like this. It's too dreadful. What have I done all these years, and why?
We did it for Sam, Nina, to keep him from losing his mind. Sam had to have a child. We gave him ours. Remember?
Oh, forgive me, Ned.
Nina, you've given me the only happiness I've ever known. And no matter what I may say or do in bitterness, I'm proud and grateful. Well, I'm going away again, Nina.
Oh.
I don't know how long this time. I won't be seeing you again, so I'll say goodbye now.
Oh, Ned. Oh, my dear.
Once more, Nina. Kiss me again.
Always. Forever, darling. Always.
Sir. Ned, did you see? I had the queerest feeling just then that someone was standing.
Mother! Uncle Charlie's here. Shall he come right up?
Yes, Gordon, of course. His voice sounded funny, did it to you? You suppose he saw?
Possible to be on the safe side. You'd better tell him you kissed me goodbye to get rid of me.
Hello, Nina. Congratulations on your son's birthday. Hello, Darryl.
Hello, Marsden.
Last time I saw you, you were leaving next day for the West Indies. Something here you couldn't tear yourself away from.
Ned is sailing this week, Charlie.
Yes. I expect to be gone at least 2 years this time. 2 years of hard work.
Biology. Must be an interesting study. I wish I knew more about it.
It's too bad you don't, Marsden. Then you might write more about life and less about dear old ladies and enchanting bachelors. Why don't you write a novel about life sometimes, Marsden?
I will one day, Darryl, I promise you.
What'll you call it, My Barren Years?
Charlie, I've got a job for you. Make the salad dressing for lunch, you know, the one I'm so crazy about.
Righto, Nina, you bet.
And Ned, wait here a moment while I see what Gordon is up to, will you? I'm worried about him.
Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday, dear
What's that? A package. Maybe it's a present, huh?
What's it doing out here in the hall?
Holy smoke. Looky, a boat. Oh, gosh, she's beautiful. Look at that mast and the rigging. Gee, I wonder who...
To Gordon from his Uncle Ned with love and affection.
From him. Darryl. I don't want it. I hate it, but... But it's so pretty. Why did it have to come from him? I've got to do it. I've got to. He kissed Mother just a minute ago. She kissed him. I saw them. I've got to do it. Darryl! Darryl! Hey, Darryl, did you...
Did I?
I found this out in the hall. Your present.
I was hoping you'd like it.
No. And here's what I think of you. There. There's your old boat in 1,000,000 pieces. You can keep it.
You mean little devil. You don't get that from me.
You shouldn't have done that, son. What difference do I make? It was never my boat, but it was your boat. You should consider the boat, not me. Don't you like boats for themselves? I thought you did. That's why I brought
it. It's awful pretty. I didn't want to do it. Honest, I didn't. I love boats. But I hate you.
So I've observed.
More than ever now. More than ever. I saw you kissing Mother. I saw Mother, too.
But I was saying goodbye. We're old friends. You know that.
You can't fool me. This was different. It'd serve you good and right. And Mother, too, if I was to tell Dad on you.
Listen. There are things a man of honor doesn't tell anyone. Not his father or mother. You want to be a man of honor, don't you? Boy, there are things we don't tell, you and I. This is my son. I love him.
We? Who do you mean? Why do I like him now? I like him awful. Listen, Darryl. I've got honor more than you. You don't have to tell me. I wasn't going to tell Dad anyway. Honest, I wasn't.
Hello, everybody.
Buck up, son. Wipe those tears. Here's your dad. Hurry, hide that broken boat under the sofa or he'll ask questions.
How's the old son? How's the birthday coming along?
Fine, Dad, fine.
Hello, Ned. Isn't this kid of mine a whopper for his age, though? Just a chip off the old block.
Yes. Now it hurts to see my son, his son. I've had enough. Get out. Any excuse. If I stay here one moment longer, I'll yell out the whole business.
I was just leaving, Sam.
Oh, then you won't be here for lunch.
I'm sorry.
I'll yell the truth into your ears if I stay a second longer, you half-witted fool.
I've got lots to do, Sam. I'm sailing in a few days. So long. So long, Gordon.
So long, Uncle Ned.
In a moment, we will continue with the third act of Strange Interlude, produced by the Theater Guild on the Air and presented by the United States Steel Corporation. And here again, speaking for United States Steel, is George Hicks.
The history of the past few years and the news we read in our daily papers has made us all realize the tremendous importance of oil to modern civilization. It is often said that our world runs on oil, and its supply has become a vital factor not only in our private lives, but in international relations as well. The importance of oil is an old story to at least one member of the United States Steel family. The Oil Well Supply Company of Dallas, Texas, which supplies machinery and knowledge for producing and drilling for oil. For over 80 years, this company has been helping men to get the oil they needed. Back in 1879, the small company, which until then had been working only in America, was called on to help open a major field in Asia. The founders of the company decided then and there on a policy of worldwide service. Within 10 years, the company was furnishing men and materials for oil developments all over the globe. That service has continued ever since. Some strange problems have been met and solved during these years. Oil Well Supply was the first to make all steel equipment because a field in Africa was so hot that wood could not be used. At another time, massive equipment had to be built in sections that weighed no more than 250 pounds because the drilling location was 12,000 feet up in the mountains of Bolivia and all the machinery had to be carried there on the backs of burros. Oil Well Supply has sent men and equipment to every continent and almost every country. As the world's oldest manufacturer and supplier of oil well equipment, the Oil Well Supply Company is constantly working to improve machinery and to help develop new fields. In recent years, the company has devoted itself particularly to the job of helping the development of oil fields in Brazil, Mexico, and Canada, nations close to home. Helping men all over the world to drill for and produce more of the oil, which makes them more prosperous and more comfortable, is the job of this member of the industrial family that serves the nation, United States Steel.
And now the curtain rises on the third act of the Theater Guild on-the-air production of Eugene O'Neill's prize-winning drama, Strange Interlude, sponsored by the United States Steel Corporation, starring Lynn Fontanne. One, two, five, 10, 11 years went by. Nina, approaching 50, still retained much of her lovely youthful figure. Sam was a millionaire now. He took on weight, and his face reddened when he was excited. Ned Darrell seemed to come through the ordeal of time in the best shape. Somehow, he seemed younger than the rest of us. It was on a June day that we were all together again, the four of us. Also Gordon's fiancée, a girl named Madeline Arnold. We'd sailed up the Hudson in Sam Evans' yacht to see the Poughkeepsie Regatta, and especially to watch Gordon, now a senior at college, who was rowing in his last race.
Can't see a thing. Here, Madeline, take these binoculars. You've got young eyes.
Thank you, Mr. Evans.
Soon the time of the race to start. Gosh, I'll bet Gordon's some keyed up right at this moment.
Oh, poor kid, I'll bet he is. Don't you think so, Miss Evans?
Yes, my son must be quite nervous.
The tone in her voice, her love already possesses him, my son. But she won't. She won't have him. As long as I live, I'll keep my son.
Come on, Gordon!
Sam, I told you I have a splitting headache.
I'm sorry. Why don't you take some aspirin?
And don't get so excited. It's bad for your blood pressure.
Hello, everybody. Race start yet?
Not yet, Ned. Come here and tell Sam how bad all this yelling and excitement is for him.
Oh, I guess Sam's all right, Nina.
He does look as if he might have a bad blood pressure, though. What hope that would have given me at one time. No more, thank the Lord.
Come on in the cabin, Ned, and shoot a drink. We can't see the start of the race from here. Maybe we can touch it on the radio.
No, Sam, leave Ned with me. I want to talk to him. Charlie's in there, and you can take Madeline.
Okay, how about a drink, Madeline?
Thank you, I don't mind if I do.
She takes a fine do this, do that little girl tone toward me. I'll give in to her now, but once I'm married to Gordon, things will be different.
Well, Ned.
Well, Nina.
My old lover. How well and young he looks. Now we no longer love each other at all. Our account with the Creator is settled. Happiness paid for with years of pain, love, passion, ecstasy. In what far-off life were they alive? The only living life is in the past and future. The present is an interlude. Strange interlude in which we call upon the past and future to bear witness that we are living. I must be careful with Ned. I must keep very cool and sensible, or he won't help me against Madeline. What is he thinking of, I wonder?
And now, what? What is she thinking? I can look into her eyes, strange eyes that will never grow old. Without desire or jealousy or bitterness, can she be the mother of my child? Is there such a person as my son? I can't think of these things as real anymore. They must have happened in another life.
Ned?
Yes, Nina?
Ned, I haven't seen you look so young and handsome since I first knew you. Tell me your secret.
That's easy. Work. I've become as interested in biology as I ever was in medicine, Nina. Our experimental station in Antigua is a big success. We've made some pretty important discoveries. I say we. I really mean young Preston. He's a fine boy, Nina. One who possesses the rare virtue of gratitude.
So you found the sun while I was losing mine. Who is yours, too?
What do you mean, Nina, while you were losing?
Oh, I've lost my son, Ned. Sam has made him all his. And it was done so gradually that although I realized what was happening, there was never any way I could interfere. What Sam advised was always what Gordon himself wanted. What do I care whether he's an athlete or not? It's such nonsense, all this fuss. I'm not the slightest bit interested in whether Gordon's crew comes in first or last.
They're off. Mr. Evans is getting something on the radio. Navy and Washington are leading. Gordon third.
There's a young lady who seems to care a lot whether Gordon comes in last or not.
Yes, Gordon is hers now, Ned. That is, they're engaged. But of course, that doesn't necessarily mean... Can you imagine his throwing himself away on a little fool like that? Why, she's hardly even pretty. She's deadly stupid.
I can't agree with you, Nina. I find her quite charming.
Well, if he marries her, it means he'll forget me. She'll keep him away from me. I know what wives can do. He mustn't marry her, Ned. Our son mustn't marry her. You'll have to give our son a good talking to, Ned. You must keep him from ruining his life.
I swore I'd never again meddle with human lives, Nina. And I wouldn't help you in this anyway. You've got to give up owning people, meddling in their lives as if you were God and had created them.
I don't know what you mean, Ned. Gordon's my son, isn't he?
And mine. Mine, too. Don't ever forget that, Nina.
Shh, yourself.
Yes, I've got it on the radio. Gordon third. Navy and Washington leading. Gordon said they were the ones to fear, Navy especially. You ought to see old Charlie. He started throwing scotch into him as if he were drinking against time. I had to take the bottle away from him. Madeline asked me if you'd like to come with me, Nina.
No, thanks. You go ahead.
All right. I don't want to miss anything.
Madeline's Gordon. Sam's Gordon. The thanks I get for saving Sam at the sacrifice of my own happiness. I won't have it. What do I care what happens to Sam now I hate him? I'll tell him Gordon is not his child and threaten to tell Gordon, too, unless he finds some excuse to break their engagement. But Ned must back me up or Sam won't believe me. Ned, isn't it time to tell Sam the truth? We've suffered all our lives for his sake. We've made him rich and happy. It's time he gave us back our son.
Gave us back? Aha, so that's it. Tell Sam the truth at last. So that's what she... Our son? You mean yours, my dear. Kindly count me out of any further meddling with...
Sam won't believe me if I'm the only one to tell him. You've got to tell him too, Ned.
I've stopped meddling in Sam's life,
but
I tell you.
Think of what Sam has made us go through, of how he's made us suffer. You've got to tell him. You still love me a little, don't you, Ned? Oh, if I'd only gone away with you that time when you came back from Europe, how happy we would have been, dear. How our boy would have loved you if it hadn't been for Sam.
Would he? Yes, if it hadn't been for Sam. I would have been happy. I would have been the world's greatest neurologist. My boy would have loved me and I'd have loved him.
You must tell him, Ned, for my sake. Because I love you, dear. Because you remember us. You must tell Sam.
Must I, Nina?
Yes, yes, you must.
Must what? What must I do? Meddle again?
Hey, we're all right. How about a drink, Del?
Marsden, thank goodness. Come on over here, Charlie, and sit down. He's drunk. Good old Charlie. He saved me from her. I must get this over quickly. No, Nina, sorry, but I can't help you. I told you I'd never again meddle with human lives. I mean that with all my heart.
Oh, very well, Ned. I've lost him. He'll never tell Sam now. Oh, dear God, help me get back my son. I must find some other way.
Hello, you two. Why do you both look so guilty? Never mind.
Look, there's oars splashing in the water way up there. They're coming. I'll tell Sam.
Ned, don't go. What did he say? He'll tell Sam. He'll tell. No, he doesn't mean that. I must find some other way.
Now, Nina, don't worry your pretty head. It'll all come out all right. We'll only have a little while longer to wait, and then you and I'll be quietly married. The devil, what am I saying? I'm drunk, all right. All the better. I've wanted all my life to tell her. Of course, Nina, I realize you've got a husband in the prison, but never mind. I can wait. I waited a lifetime already.
They're coming. Over here, Mr. Evans, you can see them.
Give me those binoculars. Oh, yes, I see them. Come on, Gordon, boy.
Come on, Gordon. Can you see from there, Mrs. Evans? Wouldn't you like to come up here?
No, no, thank you. I hate her. I must think of something. Something. Why not tell her, as Sam's
Mother told me of the insanity. After all, she does think Gordon is Sam's son.
How that would be poetic justice. That would solve everything. She wouldn't marry Gordon then. Gordon would turn to me for comfort. I must plan it out carefully, though.
Who's ahead? Confound it, I can't tell. Can you see, Nina?
No, dear. I can tell Madeline confidentially. I can pretend I'm forced to tell her as Sam's mother did with me. Because I feel it's due to her happiness and Gordon. It will explain my objection to the engagement.
Oh, he can't help succeeding. My son will come back. I'll see he never gets away again.
Madeline.
Navy's ahead, Affleck. Come on, Gordon.
Madeline.
Mrs. Evans is calling you, Madeline.
Why is she calling Madeline? I've got to watch Nina. I've got to watch her carefully.
Yes, Mrs. Evans.
Come here a moment, dear. I want to talk to you.
But they're getting closer. Why don't you come over to the rail and watch?
No, there's something I must tell you.
But, all right. Excuse me, Dr. Darrell.
Certainly, my dear.
Yes, Mrs. Evans.
Madeline. You must first give me your word of honor that you will never reveal a word of what I'm going to tell you to a living soul. Above all, not Gordon.
Couldn't you tell me later, Mrs. Evans, after the race?
No, now. Do you promise?
Yes, Mrs. Evans.
For the sake of your future happiness and my son's, I've got to speak. Madeline, you can't marry Gordon.
What?
I speak as your friend.
But why?
Why? I'll tell you why. I'll tell you exactly why. Madeline, I've something to tell you that will make it clear to you why Gordon and you can never, never marry.
I said no, Nina. Madeline, as a doctor, I feel it my duty to tell you that Mrs. Evans isn't herself.
Ned.
Pay no attention to anything she may say to you. She's very nervous and upset just now. She's also morbidly jealous of you and subject to queer delusions.
How dare you, Ned?
So go ahead. Get back to your post on the rail and watch the race.
Thank you, Dr. Darrell. Poor Mrs. Evans, I understand.
Ned. Why did you...
I'm sorry, Nina, but I warned you not to meddle. And Gordon is, well, sort of my stepson, isn't he? And I want to see him happy.
They're coming! Can you see them, Madeline? Can you tell which...
No, not yet. They all look even from here. Oh, dear, this is awful. Come on, Gordon!
The one in the middle seems to be ahead. Sam, is that Gordon?
No, it's Navy! Come on, Gordon, put your back into it. Stress! Look, Gordon's going up on the...
Here they come, here they come! They're both sprinting. I can see Gordon.
Come on, son. Lift her out of the water. Row. Row. He's gaining. Now, over the line, boys. Over with her. Stroke. You're near the finish. Stroke. Struck.
Oh, no. Sam. Sam.
He's
fainted. Ned. It's Sam.
Just a minute. It looks like a bad stroke. He's alive, though. Give me a hand with him, Charlie. We better get him.
The race is over. Gordon won. Sam Evans died a few months later. After the funeral, we all returned to the Evans home on Long Island. As I wandered through the corridors of the silent, empty house, I noticed Gordon and Madeline out on the terrace talking.
There, dear. I know how horribly hard it is for you. I loved him, too. Your father was always so wonderful and sweet to me.
I didn't realize he was gone until out there at the cemetery. Oh,
Gordon, darling, please don't.
Why? I still don't see why he had to die. It was that constant grind at the office. I couldn't watch him, but I can't see why Mother didn't.
Oh, now, you mustn't start feeling bitter toward her.
I know I shouldn't, but...
Since he was taken sick, she's been with him every minute. I never saw such devotion.
Yes, she sure was wonderful to him, all right. But, well, this may sound rotten of me. I always had a queer feeling she was doing it as a duty.
What?
Madeline, I've never told you this, but I've always felt ever since I was a little kid that she didn't really love Dad.
Gordon.
She liked him and respected him. She was a wonderful wife. But I'm sure she didn't love him.
Oh, darling.
I'll tell you, Madeline. I've always felt she cared a lot for Darrell. Of course, I might be wrong. No, I'm not wrong. Ever since I was a kid. And then when I was 11, something happened. I've been sure of it since then.
Sorry to disturb you two young people.
That's all right, Uncle Charlie.
I've been picking some roses for your mother, Gordon. Here you are, Madeline. A rose for you. Hail, love. We who have died salute you.
Thank you, Uncle Charlie.
Where's Mother? Still in the house?
Yes, I'm going in now. Shall I tell her you want to see her?
Please, and ask Daryl to come out with her.
I'll go down to the plane and wait for you, dear. You want to fly back before dark, don't you?
Yes.
Goodbye for a while, darling. Don't be too long.
I won't. Madeline's wonderful. I sure don't deserve my luck. But it seems rotten and selfish to be happy when dead. It's funny how I got to care more for Dad than for Mother. I suppose it was finding out that she loved Daryl. I can remember that day seeing her kiss him. Here they come. Mother and Daryl. Funny, I can't stand it even now when I see him with Mother. I'd like to beat him up. Mother, I asked you to come out here because there are certain things connected with Dad's will I thought I ought to... I don't believe Dad told you about his will, did he, Mother?
No, no.
Well, the whole estate goes to you and me, of course. But there is one provision that is peculiar, to say the least. It concerns you, Dr. Darrell. $500,000 for your experimental station to be used in biological research.
What's
work.
That? You're not serious. I won't accept it, and that's final.
It's not left to you, but to the station. If you won't carry on, I suppose whoever is in real charge down there will be only too glad to accept it.
That means my assistant, Preston. But Sam didn't even know him. No, Preston is none of his business. I'll advise him to refuse it. But it's for science. I have no right to refuse. Blast Sam. Wasn't it enough for him to own the woman I love and our son in his lifetime? Now, in death, he reaches out to steal Preston, to steal my work.
It isn't for you, Ned, nor for Preston. It's for science. You must look at it that way.
You'd better accept. $500,000 aren't being thrown away for nothing every
all
day.
All right, Gordon, I think you've said enough.
I haven't said all I'm going to say, Mother.
Gordon, don't.
Well, what have you got to say? Your mother and I are waiting.
Shut up, you. Don't take that tone with me or I'll forget your age and give you a spanking.
Gordon! Spanking? The son spanks the father? Oh, Gordon! Oh, Gordon, don't make me laugh. It's all so funny.
Nina, don't mind him. He doesn't realize.
Don't I? I realize a lot. I realize you've acted like a cur. And here's something I've been meaning to do since the day I was 11 years old.
Oh, stop, Gordon. What would your father say? You don't know what you're doing. You're hitting your father.
No, it's all right, son. It's all right. You didn't know.
I'm sorry. Sorry. You're right, Mother. Dad would feel as if I'd hit him. Just as bad as if I'd hit him.
It's nothing, son, nothing.
Oh, that's swell of you, Daryl. It was a rotten, dirty trip. Accept my apology, Daryl. Won't you?
Sure. Sure, son. Daryl, he calls me Daryl. But doesn't he know? I thought you told him.
Gordon, how could you? I told him he hit his father. But he can't understand me. Of course he can't. How could he? After all these years.
Mother, stop laughing, please. It's all right between Daryl and me. I've apologized. I just want you to know how fine I think you both acted. I've known ever since I was a kid that you and Daryl were in love with each other. I hated the idea on Father's account. That's only natural, isn't it? But I knew it was unfair. That people can't help loving each other any more than... I've got to say goodbye, Mother. Goodbye, Daryl. I hope you two will get married right away.
Wait, Gordon.
Why does he keep on calling me Daryl? He's my boy. I'm his father. I've got to make him realize I'm his father.
Listen, Gordon, son. It's my turn now. I've got to tell you something.
Ned. Oh, he mustn't. I feel he mustn't. He mustn't tell. Not now. Ned, please. First, let me ask Gordon a question.
Yes, Mother. What is it?
Gordon, do you think Ned and I, that is...
Mother, what do you think I am? I know you're the best woman that ever lived, the best of all. I don't even accept Madeline.
Oh, my dear Gordon, you do love me, don't you?
Of course, Mother. I've always loved you.
Now go. Hurry. Madeline is waiting. Give her my love. Come and see me once in a while in the years to come. Goodbye, dear. Ned, do you still want to tell Gordon something?
No, Nina. Not for anything in the world. Goodbye, son.
Goodbye, Uncle Ned.
Poor dear Ned, you always had to give. How can I ever thank you?
By refusing me when I ask you to marry me. I've got to ask you. Gordon expects it. And he'll be so pleased when he knows you've turned me down. Hello, here comes Charlie. I've got to hurry. Nina, will you marry me?
No, certainly not. Our ghosts would torture us to death. But I wish I did love you, Ned. I wish you loved me as we did long, long ago.
That's the Ned to remember, Nina. Forget me. I'm going back to work. I'll leave you to Charlie. You'd better marry him, Nina, if you want peace. He's been waiting a long time.
Do I hear my name taken in vain?
Dear old Charlie, come here.
Peace. Yes, that's all I desire now. Charlie has found peace. He will be tender as my father was when I was a little girl.
Ned just proposed to me, Charlie. I refused him. I don't love him anymore.
I suspected as much. Then whom do you love, Nina?
You, Charlie, I suppose. I've always loved your love for me. It brings me peace.
All my life I've waited to bring you peace, Nina.
I know. You want me to marry you, Charlie?
Yes, Nina, I do.
Bless you, my children. Bless you.
That's Gordon, up there in his plane. Gordon! Goodbye, dear. See, Ned, he's leaving me without a backward look.
No, he's circling. He's coming back. He's going to pass directly over us. See, he's waving to us.
Goodbye, Gordon. Goodbye, my dear son.
Nina, are you forgetting he's my son, too? You're my son, Gordon. You're my son.
It's no use. He can't hear. He can't.
Goodbye, Gordon. Fly up to heaven, dear. Fly with your love to heaven. Fly always. Never crash to earth like my old love, Gordon. Be happy, dear. You've got to be happy.
The curtain has fallen on a Theater Guild production of Strange Interlude, presented by the United States Steel Corporation. Nin Fontaine was starred as Nina. Walter Abel was featured as Dr. Darrell. Donald MacDonald as Sam Evans. Alfred Shirley as Charlie Marsden. Donald Buca as Young Gordon. Michael Artist as the Boy Gordon. And Joan Tompkins as Madeline. And here again is Lawrence Langer to tell you about next week's Theater Guild play, to be presented by the United States Steel Corporation. Mr. Langner.
Ladies and gentlemen, first I'd like to thank Miss Fontaine and the rest of the cast of Strange Interlude for their work in presenting this important play to our audience. Next week we'll bring you Walter Pidgeon in George M. Cohan's famous comedy melodrama, Seven Keys to Baldpate. This play has become an American classic, and we think you'll find it both amusing and entertaining. With Mr. Pidgeon will be Martha Scott, now starring on Broadway in The Voice of the Turtle. And now here's Mr. Brokenshire again.
The United States Steel Corporation hopes that you'll be with us again next week at the same time when the Theater Guild on the air will present George M. Cohan's comedy melodrama, The Seven Keys to Baldpate, starring Walter Pidgeon and Martha Scott. For the Theater Guild on the air includes Homer Thicket, director, George Condolph, producer, and Armina Marshall, executive director of the radio department. Music for tonight's play was composed and conducted by Harold Levy, and the play adapted for radio by Arthur Aaron. Your announcer, Norman Brokenshire.
American Broadcasting Company.